Good evening. It's Wednesday again. How did that happen? Woke up this morning, it was about Sunday. Anyway, welcome to our 16th virtual Noir at the Bar. I'm Vic Watson. I usually run the Harrogate and Newcastle chapters, but for 16 weeks now, we've been beamed live into your home. Tonight, we are hosting Rachel Abbott, Egan Hughes, Jane Roberts-Morpeth, Sharon Bolton, Chris McGeorge, Jennifer Harvey, Tammy Cohen, Amanda Jennings, Rachel Sargeant, and Elle Croft. Woo! You got an extra woo thrown in there because somebody requested it on Twitter. Don't forget, you've got the Q&A button around here. So if you've got any questions for our panelists tonight, please do ask away and I shall endeavour to get the writer to respond. You also have the chat button, so have a chat with your fellow audience members. And our panellists, that's absolutely fine. But don't chat during the readings, otherwise I'll have to get very teacherly with you. If you would like to be entered into our prize draw to win a book tonight, please email vnatb20@gmail.com with the subject heading enter. Tonight, our music is from The Handsome Family and Jason Isaacs. How lucky are we? Just all these fantastic musicians giving us their music. How lovely. If you hear something you really like when I read out an introduction, please give us a woo. And while I'm shaking the all new and improved hat with the names in, please do give me a drum roll so I can feel like I'm in a real bar. If you hear something during a reading you like, please do pop it in the chat and we will consider it for quote of the week. I think that's all I need to tell you. I think I've talked enough. Let's get on with it because we've got some amazing readers tonight. So settle back. Get ready for an evening of noir. Cheers. So get ready with your drum rolls, please, for our first reader tonight. It is the lovely Rachel Abbott. Yay! Rachel Abbott began writing for pleasure 10 years ago. At the time, she had absolutely no intention of publishing. Her novels have now sold over 4 million copies. Woo! She lives on the beautiful island of Alderney in the Channel Islands, where she writes full time. So everybody, it is my pleasure to introduce to you Rachel Abbott.
Good evening, everybody. I hope you can hear me okay. And it's thanks so much for listening in. It's a real pleasure to be here this evening. I'm going to read a couple of extracts tonight from The Murder Game, which I hope you can see. And I'm pleased to say this is currently 99p on Amazon, but in America it's actually known as The Invitation. The first extract I'm going to read is the prologue. I reached for the door handle with shaking fingers, wishing I'd said no, that I'd refused to play the game that's planned for tonight. Maybe I'm not as brave as I'd like to think. I clutched the black envelope in my other hand, holding it close to my body, as if somehow the words on the card inside might burn their way through its satin smooth parchment for all to see. As I step into the corridor, other doors open and I struggle not to gasp at the sight of Isabel in her silver sheath and Chandra in her long turquoise silk skirt. I feel dizzy with memories, but I suppose that's the point of the game. No one speaks, and without a shared smile between us, we trail down the elegant stairway. I glance at Matt, my husband of 3 years, and I don't know if I recognise him anymore. His face is set, his mouth a straight line, and his own black envelope is peeking out of his jacket pocket. He sees me looking and reaches up to push it firmly out of sight. How different from the night a year ago, when we'd all spilled from our rooms, excited about both the evening ahead and the wedding the following day. I've tried to ask Matt what he thinks tonight's game is all about, but he refuses to discuss it. Apparently it's what Lucas wants, and what Lucas wants, Lucas gets, at least as far as my husband is concerned. Not that I know what Matt is thinking anymore. Most unhappy couples, I suspect, are unable to identify the moment their relationship begins to disintegrate, when closeness turns to distance and banter becomes thinly disguised contempt. I, on the other hand, can pinpoint exactly when my marriage began to crumble. Our life together had seemed effortless up to that point, as if we were swimming side by side in a calm river. But then the surface of the water changed. We hit the rapids and we were wrenched apart. Now we can see each other in the distance, but we seem unable or unwilling to steer ourselves back into still waters together. It's 1 year to the day, almost to the hour, since we began to hurtle in opposite directions, and now it feels as if there's nothing to cling to, no rescue in sight. Yet we've never discussed it, because to acknowledge it, we would have to refer to the event that tore us apart, and we would have to talk about Alex. So that's the end of the first one. I'm just going to take a sip of a drink, I apologise. But we are at a bar, so it seems fair enough. The next extract comes from a point at which Lucas begins to tell them about the game they're going to be playing. Whatever's going on, it seems I'm the only one who is concerned. As we congregate on the terrace for lunch, I look around at the smiling faces. Everyone seems more relaxed today, but maybe they don't know about the costumes yet. Isabel laughs at something Matt says to Nick and slaps him playfully on the leg. His lips tighten momentarily at her touch and I turn away. I can feel Andrew watching me. I don't want him to see the confusion behind my eyes, so I stare blindly around as if taking in the scenery. Chandra is quiet, as she often is, and Nina seems tense. I wonder how things have been for them this year. Terrible, I imagine. The air is hot and still today, with barely a breath of breeze. The glass on the table in front of me has been filled to the brim with cold white wine by Nick, who seems once again to have taken on the role of volunteer barman. And condensation is running down the outside. I take a large gulp as Lucas comes out of the house and approaches us, clutching a wooden box in his hands. Everybody falls silent as he places it in the centre of the table and sits down. He casts his eyes over each of his guests in turn, holding everyone's gaze for a couple of seconds before moving on. After a long pause, he begins to speak. As I mentioned to you yesterday, I'm grateful you all agreed to come, and to make tonight memorable, I prepared a party game. Lucas points to the wooden box, which looks a little like an old-fashioned cigarette box. In here are a number of envelopes, one for each of you. Inside is a profile of the role you'll be playing tonight, but please don't open them yet, not until after lunch. When we've eaten, I'd like each of you to find a private place to read your character description. True to this type of game, each of you has been given a secret, which may or may not be revealed during the evening, depending on how well you play the game. But to make the party a success, you mustn't tell anyone, not even your partner, what the secret is. As I watch Lucas's face, I don't like what I'm seeing. There's a hard edge to him, and although he's smiling, there's a bitter twist to his mouth. To avoid unnecessary confusion, you'll each use your own name for your character. Let's stick to reality, learn your parts well, bring your envelopes with you tonight, and let's make the evening a success. Suddenly, it seems I may not be the only one who's uncomfortable. Nick has omitted to fill Lucas's glass, and Isabel is staring blankly at a spot in the centre of the table. I will Matt to look at me so I can tell what he's thinking, but he doesn't. He has a slightly inane grin on his face that tells me nothing. I need to see his eyes. But no one questions Lucas. He pulls the box towards him and opens it, taking out eight black envelopes, each with a name on the front, beautifully written in silver ink. He hands them out to the now silent table, placing one in front of himself and one in front of Nina. She reaches for hers and I see her fingers tremble a little. How much does she know of her husband's plan? Nina clears her throat. As you know, I prepared costumes for each of you. You'll find everything you need in your rooms before dinner. She looks at no one as she speaks. I desperately want to open my envelope now, and I'm sure I'm not alone. I prop it against my water glass, but I can't take my eyes off it, so I pick it up and stuff it into the pocket of my shorts, where it's hidden from view. Everyone starts to talk at once, as if compelled to cover the momentary hiatus, and there's a distinct sense of frenzy around the table, the laughter sharp, brittle. Everyone seems to be trying to be jovial, the wariness of a few moments ago hidden under a pretense that this is perfectly normal. Only Chandra is quiet as she helps herself to some of the salad that Adriana brought out to accompany her kimchi. When I lift my eyes to look round the table, I find Lucas is staring at me as if he can see right into my thoughts. I don't even attempt to smile and look straight back at him. After a few seconds, one corner of his mouth lifts and he gives me an almost imperceptible nod, as if I've passed some test I hadn't been aware I was taking. Lunch seems to take forever, and just when I think it's over, Adriana appears again, this time with a dish of strawberry semifreddo. It's sitting in a puddle of raspberry coulis, which to me looks exactly like a pool of blood. Thank you for listening, and now back to you, Vic.
Thank you so much for that, Rachel. We've actually got a question from Joanne Burns for you. She would like to know, would you ever bring Tom Douglas and Stephanie King together in the same novel?
Ah, that's an interesting one. Well, one of them would have to travel quite a way, because Tom's based in Manchester and Stephanie's based in Cornwall. It has been asked before, and I don't actually have any plans to do that, but never say never is what I would say.
Excellent. Thank you so much, and thanks for joining us this evening. That was great.
Thanks for listening.
Thank you. Right, who's next? What a way to start. I know there's some newbies in the bar tonight, so thank you for joining us. And I know there's some familiar faces, so thanks to all of you for joining us. Our second reader tonight is Egan Hughes. Let me tell you about Egan. Egan Hughes writes twisty psychological thrillers. Her debut novel is called The One That Got Away. It was shortlisted for the Richard and Judy Search for a Bestseller competition. Woo! So everybody, please put your hands together for the lovely Egan Hughes.
Thank you. I'm going to read from The One That Got Away, which is out now in audio and ebook and in paperback on the 6th of August. Panic gripped me when they said he died. The floor listed at a woozy angle. Someone shot him on his boat, the man said. I shut my eyes and pictured the gun, his gun. I gasped as if the air had been sucked from the room. You okay, Mia? I opened my eyes and tried to calm myself. I wanted the shaking to ease off, along with the blotches in my vision. Take your time, I know it's a shock. The two officers in navy suits filled my sofa with their combined bulk and cigarette smell. I burned from their scrutiny. Before all this happened, I never said my ex's name because I wanted to forget him and forget what happened. Then the police turned up and he was everywhere. We need to ask you some questions as part of the murder investigation. The female officer sat with her notebook poised. When did you last see him? It was all I could do to keep breathing. My throat tightened and thoughts of him crowded in. About 2 years ago, you took out an injunction, is that right? At least my vision was coming back to normal. The panic attack began to ease. I managed them better now, so I didn't look like someone falling apart. The trick was to slow your breathing and focus on something solid. I studied a cobweb on the fireplace, willing the police to leave. I didn't want them looking at me and seeing the damage. Mia, did you take out an injunction against him? I just, as a precaution, I didn't. My voice was jagged. I tripped over the words. I never could hide my feelings. Drink your tea. I took a gulp and set it back down. Despite my shaking hands, I managed not to spill any. He threatened to kill you, is that right? I don't think he meant it. She gave me a wearisome look. It got bad before we split up. We weren't right for each other. I had this urge to explain so they'd see I wasn't the sort of person to get death threats. I wanted them to know how he came along and made me happy. It was like this gift. But it wasn't mine to keep because it wasn't real. Not that they cared. Darcy lay sphinx-like at my feet, one Alsatian ear standing up and the other flopping down. Mr. Darcy, my guard dog, both of us wary of people we didn't know. You did the right thing to take out an injunction. It can be dangerous when you leave a man like him. He'd have wanted to keep you under his control. What happened is, it's awful, but I don't know him anymore. I didn't know he'd remarried. To be fair, I never knew him. He mostly pretended to be someone else, someone better. There was more to him beyond the surface, none of it good. My teeth worried at a fingernail, and the officers watched me in silence. My panic subsided a few degrees. The woman drummed a biro on her restless leg, her hair scraped into a thin ponytail. Her rugged colleague might have been my type once upon a time. The younger me would have looked into his eyes and imagined hidden depths, because that's how I was back then. So you last saw Rob Creevy 2 years ago, yes? He asked. Yes. We held each other's stare. I blinked first and steeled myself for more questions. They exchanged a glance and the woman snapped her notebook shut. That's everything, the male officer said. You've answered our questions, for now. He lingered over the last two words and my heart dipped at the thought of them coming back. He gave me a business card with his number in case I thought of anything relevant. I nodded and studied it, even though I wouldn't be calling him. They walked into the evening gloom. I shut the door and leaned against it for a long time. Then I sat on the stairs and gave in to the shaking. Time passed while I stared at a patch of black mould on the wall. My thoughts swirled, my clammy hands wedged between my knees. I'd escaped from Rob when everything turned bad, but now I'd been plunged back in. Mr. Darcy nudged my elbow until I wrapped my arms around him. He nuzzled against the side of my face, a furry blanket of reassurance. I'd hold on to what was good and find a way through. He flopped down beside me, watching with concerned brown eyes. It's okay, Darcy, we'll be okay. I stroked the fur between his ears and he closed his eyes. A glass of wine would help my dry throat and numb the anxiety. I could finish that open bottle in the fridge, not to get off my head, just to escape it for a while. But even that wasn't enough to move me from the hall, where I stayed hunched as if shackled. I used to think the past would settle behind me, but it crept up and pulled me back where I didn't want to go. I went over what I'd tried to forget, what my memory kept alive, because even in death he had this hold on me. I replayed my lies to the police. Of course I knew about his new wife, the woman younger than me, who he loved more. I'd said I hadn't seen him for 2 years, which was also a lie. Part of me had wanted to come clean, but I didn't trust them to see it the way I did. Had the officers read the fear in my eyes, telling a story all of its own? They didn't ask for my alibi, didn't ask where I was when he died. What if they came back and asked those questions? Could I lie again? Thank you. Back to you, Vic.
Thank you so much for that, Egan. Okay, right. We are on to our final reader of our first part of the evening. I told you they were good, didn't I? I said it was a good week. It is Jane Roberts-Morpeth. So, Jane Roberts-Morpeth loves the dark and the spooky. She is a two-time Storytime winner and writes a weekly column for the Film Stories website. Her debut short story collection, The Repository of Lost Souls, is now available on Amazon. I've been a Storytime judge for North Tyneside Libraries for several years now. I can't remember how many. And when we went into lockdown, we announced the Storytime 2019 results. And I just felt, because we usually do a performance evening, I felt that the people who'd won were missing out a little bit this year. So I invited Jane to join us at the virtual bar. So please, everybody, give a massive round of applause for Jane Roberts-Morpeth.
Hi, everyone. I hope you can hear me okay. Yes, tonight I'm actually going to read my Storytime Prize winner, The Punishment Principle, which I'm hoping to put into the second short story collection that I'm actually creating at the moment. So here we go. Betsy was finding infamy quite intolerable. Curtains twitched, noses touched glass as she walked down the quiet crescent to her Fawkes Tudor bungalow. It wasn't even her crime. She'd been home behind her white pebble dash walls, bleaching the grout in the kitchen tiles when Roger came home stinking of shame. She'd been watching the front path with grim anticipation. awaiting Roger's sheepish long face as he passed through the privet arch over the gate to face her. Betsy should have realised sooner that Roger hadn't returned home that night, but she'd moved into the back bedroom 18 months ago, out of range of his free-range paws and snores, earplugs in place every night. So no, she hadn't known Roger was out all night. She'd known he was meeting friends on the Saturday evening at the club for pie and peas, pint of bitter. Betsy was certainly bitter. First came the police car, cruising to a stop at the privet arch, an outbreak of blinds being raised in the horseshoe-shaped street. No chance of anyone missing the spectacle of one of their own being transported back in disgrace at midday on a Sunday. Her nearest neighbour, Mrs. Bunderick, waved at Betsy from her bay window. Betsy's response was limp-wristed. Bunderick's tiny eyes were popping from her head as two police officers stepped out of the car and opened the back door. There, head hanging limp, sat Roger. As he stepped out, Betsy saw he was wearing a cheap grey tracksuit. He'd gone out looking natty in his dark suit and Masonic tie. There was no sign of that now. Roger shuffled up the curved path to the bungalow's front door. Knocked. What had the man done with his keys? Was that a black eye? Betsy glanced up the street. Every window had a watcher. As she fluttered to open the front door, various scenarios flickered through her mind. Had Roger been mugged? Had someone left him helpless and naked in an alley? Was he all right? Roger stumbled into the narrow hall, bumping into the wall mirror and knocking it askew. He mumbled something at her and then disappeared into the living room. The two police officers stood at the door thresh. One was a woman. Betsy noticed this with distaste. There was something insolent about the girl's face, her scraped back bun, and a snigger on her twitching lips. The young man, he was more like it. Tall, serious, and with a look of calm compassion and big blue eyes. "May we come in, Mrs. Barry?" The young woman had a loud voice, trying to compensate for her lack of stature, Betsy thought. "Come in, officers." The hall was narrow and the officers crowded it as the door shut behind them. Betsy took her ample frame into the living room where Roger had installed himself in the armchair by the fire. He shrank further into it as they entered the room. The police officer sat on the overstuffed green couch, a cushion falling to the floor. The smirking girl boomed at Betsy. "I'm PC Joseph and this is my colleague, PC Greening. Last night, your husband was involved in an incident." Betsy steeled herself to hear the worst, eyes never leaving Roger's florid face, as PC Joseph relayed his previous night's escapade. Roger dissolved into the chair as the sorry tale unfolded. 6 weeks later, Roger had his 15 minutes in court. He pleaded guilty to drunken disorderly and received a £200 fine with £85 prosecution costs plus a verbal slap on the wrists. Betsy could swear the magistrates had been sniggering behind their lofty bench when the charge details were read. There was a reporter in court. They noted all the salient details of Roger's misdemeanour before splashing them all over the front page of the local free paper, a newspaper that was delivered to every home within a 5 mile radius of Barry's bungalow. Betsy had managed to pass off the police car and Roger's black eye to the Crescent as a mugging after Roger's quiet tipple in the club at Colour Coats. The paper laid her lie out for everyone to see. Local man arrested, naked and drunk on the last bus of the day through Whitley Bay, asleep at the back with his clothes scattered around the downstairs wheel arches. CCTV showed the comic events that had followed when the driver had parked up in a bus stop in Whitley Bay and woken him up. At which stage, Roger accused the bemused driver of stealing his clothes and had run screaming out into the road in full view of yet more cameras and the conveniently placed local police station. Crescent's quick curtain twitching went into overdrive. Betsy felt eyes on her spine as she cut the grass. She abandoned the job, half done. Roger had taken to hiding in the garden shed out the back. She could smell the whiskey oozing out from 5 feet away. He rarely left the house anymore, and for a while they squeezed past each other in the narrow corridors of the bungalow without eye contact or conversation. 2 weeks after Roger's shame had been splashed across the paper, he had a doctor's appointment. When he was out of the house, Betsy searched the shed. It was an impressive shed as these things go, with wide French doors opening to a patio, painted a pretty sage green. Roger put red shale tiles on the roof. He had a small leather couch in there and a pile of spy thrillers on a coffee table, a rag rug on the floor, and he spent most of his days in there now he was retired. The one small cupboard held nothing more than candles and matches. As she stood, hands on hips, Betsy pursed her lips. Nothing. She made to leave and tripped on the edge of the rug. As she pulled it straight, she noticed the uneven floorboard. This was what she'd been seeking. She pulled up a loose plank and peered into the neat box that Roger had built, finding plastic tumblers and two bottles of good whiskey. Betsy cooked Roger a roast one night, a month after his star turn in the local news. She opened a bottle of expensive wine, their first since the police had brought him home. She tuned the kitchen radio to a nostalgic channel, and they sang a little to Cliff and Elvis. She resisted Roger's efforts to get her to dance. She looked on his jowly face and swollen purple nose with affection. He'd been a decent enough husband those first 30 years. It was sad he managed to bring such shame to them in what should have been the golden years of their retirement. Betsy took herself off to the hairdresser's on Wednesday. Having a permanent wave, she told Roger, "I'll be ours. Get your own lunch." She ignored the look of relief that swept across his face, steeled her soft frame and plastered on a noble air of suffering for the 4 hours she endured sat in rollers and surrounded by gossip. She was in no hurry to go home. When her hair was helmeted to perfection, she took herself to the cafe around the corner from the bungalow for a cream bun and a nice pot of tea. 5 hours after she left, Betsy returned home. Mrs. Gibbs at number one turned her back on her as she turned into the crescent. Stuck up cow, she'd see. They all would. Even though she knew Roger wouldn't be indoors, Betsy had hesitated to place her key in the lock. Now it was done, it didn't seem quite real. She stepped over the marital thresh into silence. She called Roger's name and heard it echo round the small corridor. Stepped into the small kitchen, braced herself for what she might find. Nothing. The back door was open. She tottered up the crazy paving to the pretty green shed. Found Roger. It was rather more vivid in reality than in her imagination. The man slumped on the settee, had a contorted purple face, grotesque with spittle bubbling at the corners of his mouth. She pushed the door wide open. There was no movement from the couch. There was a blue plastic tumbler knocked over on the rug. The whiskey bottle was half empty on the table. Betsy smiled. She opened her little pink handbag and took out a folded piece of paper, stepped over the tumbler, and she lifted Roger's limp hand. No response. His eyes were rolled back in his head, crimson lines bursting across the milky surface. He'd not been dead long. There was residual warmth in his fingers. She pressed the fingers tenderly on the paper that she held, crumpled them up around it, let his hand fall and the paper fluttered down with it. Roger's suicide note was shortened to the point. She'd been careful to copy his terse manner of speech and general lack of emotion. But she'd left a heartfelt apology for the eternal shame that he had caused his dear wife, Betsy. As she hung up the phone after her hysterical 999 call, Betsy felt a quiet glow of satisfaction. Punishment complete, her principles upheld, respectability resumed with the added kudos of widowhood. Roger really had to go. Thank you.
Thank you so much for doing that, Jane. Congratulations again. Okay, so that is the first part of our evening over. I've got to say, if you're going to talk about us, please use that hashtag on social media. And I'm going to get the begging out of the way early this week because you know what? I just hate it. If you would like to contribute to our the running of our virtual bar, please visit our Ko-fi page. Simon and I don't make any money from this, so don't think we're going to run off to the Caribbean as soon as it's safe to do so. But unfortunately, the people who provide our platforms don't do it for love of crime fiction. So if you wouldn't mind popping a little something in the jar, it's not mandatory. Noir at the Bar is free, you know that. But just pop over there if you don't mind. So we'll be back in 5 minutes. Thank you very much.
Just a beautiful lyric. Night and day, you are the one. Only you beneath the moon or under the sun. Whether near to me or far, no matter, darling. Night. so, that this longing for you follows wherever I go. In a roaring traffic's boom, in the silence of my lonely room, I think of you. Such a hungry yearning burning inside of me, and its torment won't be through till I spend my life making love to you day and night, night and day. Song, lovely song. You see what I'm saying? You hear what I'm talking about? The lyrics. Now, what have we got these days? Well, I'll just tell you what we've got these days. We've got lyrics like, "I like big butts and I cannot lie."
Thanks to Jason Isaacs for that. My Zoom just completely disappeared and I didn't know what had happened and I was really frightened. I thought I'd lost you all. That was hideously terrifying. Let's move on to the next reader, shall we, while I recover. It's Tammy Cohen. Tammy Cohen is the author of 6 psychological thrillers and 3 works of commercial women's fiction. How does she find the time? She also writes historical fiction as Rachel Reese, and her debut, Dangerous Crossing, was a Richard and Judy pick. Woo! Tammy Cohen is also a member of the Killer Women Writing Collective. Hooray! So everybody, please, huge round of applause for Tammy Cohen.
Hi. Hello. Hi. Thank you for having me. There's a helicopter zooming around outside, so it might be a bit loud, but I hope it'll be all right. I'm going to read from Stop at Nothing, which is out now. It's about a mother who takes the law into her own hands when her daughter is attacked in their neighbourhood. And I'm going to read from the beginning because I haven't got the imagination to do anything else. in this scene, mother and daughter at the police station for an ID parade, which disappointingly is all done on video these days. Okay. "You must not speak." That was directed at me. I nodded. I was only there as silent support. I was sitting about 6 feet behind Em, slightly to her right. I could see the rounded slope of her shoulders, the hand resting on her jeans, one finger worrying away at the ragged skin around her bitten thumbnail. "There's something about your children's hands, isn't there, that goes straight to the most primeval part of you, some muscle memory ingrained from the very first time their tiny baby fingers gripped onto your own, or when a soft toddler palm reached up trustingly for yours in the street." As I watched, a small bead of blood blossomed on the side of Em's thumb, and I had to look away. The room was windowless, lesser room really than a partitioned off area of the main floor. Fluorescent strip lights, the same drab blue carpet as everywhere else in the building. The air stale and mint-edged from the gum the policewoman chewed, so her breath didn't smell of cigarettes, although her clothes reeked of them. There was another woman in the room, some kind of solicitor. She had a moon-shaped face and an impassive expression as if it was all the same to her. My daughter, the ugly thing that happened to her, all the same. The policewoman read through the script, explaining what was going to happen. A video would show showing 9 different men, and Em was to watch the entire thing through twice without commenting, after which she'd be asked if she recognized the man who assaulted her. "Is that clear?" Em nodded, then was asked to say yes out loud for the tape. Her voice sounded very small and my stomach felt tight. The video started. A man with heavy-set features and a pronounced underbite turned slowly to show first his left side, then his right, and finally face on. I sat up straight, made my expression neutral. This first man looked nervous, licked his lips, concentrated. They weren't actors. I'd already Googled it. They were volunteers who'd agreed to go on a national database in return for a tenner or something like that. The second man could hardly hide his smirk. I pressed my top teeth down onto the bottom ones, so those at the back ground together. Did he think this was funny? My daughter, only 16 years old. Was it a joke to him? Neutral face, silent support. Man number 3 was way too skinny. I could have told them that for nothing. Chunky is how Em had described her attacker in her statement to Detective Byrne. I'd been with her when she made the statement, and by the end I'd built up a pretty good idea of what the bastard looked like. Stocky, short hair, a pungent aftershave that got up her nostrils. His chin was shaped like a W, she'd said, and the tissue of my heart had torn softly. She didn't know the word for cleft, so she was making up her own description. She wanted so much to be helpful. He'd been wearing a dark padded jacket, she told us. Of course he would be, I recall thinking, along with 99% of the male population. But it had some kind of logo on the sleeve, she remembered suddenly, jubilant at having something to give us. In my mind, I saw him crystal clear. He did not look like man number 3. Man number 4 was practically bald. I frowned at the screen over Em's shoulder. She'd described his hair as short, hadn't mentioned bald. The 5th man was more like it, broad, fit, but wary, barely glancing towards the camera as he turned his head first to one side, then to the other, as if he had something to hide. I saw a muscle throbbing at his jaw. I looked at Em, trying to gauge her reaction. Her right hand was still resting on her leg, though the blood on her thumb was smeared now from being rubbed on her jeans. Man number 6 was also promising, though he had the look of someone taking his role too seriously. Frustrated actor, perhaps. People like that must gravitate towards these types of gigs, I guessed. A chance to appear on screen, perhaps with a stranger hundreds of miles away to remark, "That one is particularly good." His chin was square with a hint of a dent. Like I said, promising. Number 7 was a flat out no. Too dark, too slight. I looked at his delicate mouth, tried to imagine him hissing, "Stop, bitch," in my daughter's ear. Impossible. Then came 8. It was like a physical punch in the guts, that first sight of him. I knew him, you see. I recognised him in some primordial part of me where my daughter and I were still one, where our consciousnesses had not yet divided, where I felt what she felt and knew what she knew. He was so exactly as Em had described him, squat, muscular, skin stretched tight over the bones of his face. He had green eyes, now that was a surprise, but then it had been dark. The chin though, a perfect W, as if while he was still being formed, someone had taken a finger and pressed hard, each corner a mean point of bone. It was him, I knew it instantly. This man's neck was meaty and thick, his arms bulged and strained under his t-shirt. I imagined him hooking one of them around my daughter's own slender neck. Acid rose up in my throat. Neutral face, silent support. I don't remember anything about number 9 because number 8 was still papered all over my eyelids. After the tape had run, the policewoman reminded Em not to speak until she'd replayed it a second time. This time I didn't pay any attention to the first 7 men. Impatience knitted my muscles together, set my foot tapping against the chair leg. Even second time around, my reaction to him was visceral. I'd reached 52 years of age without wishing serious harm on anyone. I wanted him dead, wanted to split that cleft chin open, rip tissue from bone. Afterwards, the policewoman stopped the tape. Did you recognise the man who grabbed you around the neck at 00:15 hours on Saturday the 13th of January on Brownlow Road and repeatedly hit you around the head while trying to drag you off the main road? She asked my daughter. Her voice was flat, matter of fact. She could have been reading out her shopping list. Now it was coming. I bit down on my lip, already anticipating the sweet relief of it being over. Now he would get what was coming to him and we could move on with our lives. No. So certain was I of hearing yes that I thought at first I'd misheard, then that Em must have got it wrong. I sat up straighter, leaned forward, trying to tap her on the back with my mind, alert her to her mistake. This isn't the time for niceness, I wanted to tell her. Number 8, you saw him. Instead, I remained impassive, my hands on my lap, neutral, silent. That's it, back to Vic.
Thank you so much for that, Tammy. That was brilliant. I'm going to have to be more neutral. Okay, so I got the hat out there. I didn't really give it much of a shake, did I? Our next reader tonight is Elle Croft. Elle Croft is an author, true crime podcaster, blogger, and digital marketing consultant. She's written 3 psychological thrillers, and they're called Like Mother, Like Daughter, The Other Sister, and The Guilty Wife. The Guilty Wife was a Kindle top 10 bestseller.
Woo!
Elle grew up in Adelaide, South Australia, where her latest book is set, but left the sunshine behind to move to London 10 years ago. So Australia's loss is Britain's gain. Everybody, Elle Croft!
Thank you so much. So I'm going to read 2 excerpts from Like Mother, Like Daughter, which is my latest book. And the first one is the prologue, which is told from the point of view of Sally. And the second reading I'll do is from the point of view of Kat. So, Sally, serial killer. It has a ring to it, don't you think? A certain prestige. A little thrill that runs up the spine and ignites the imagination at the utterance of those 2 words. I know, I shouldn't revel in it. I'm well aware of that, and yet, well, I suppose you could say that my macabre title is more than I could ever have hoped to achieve in this life. It's my legacy. My name will be written into history books and talked about well after I die. People, smart, successful, well-respected people, will study me, will talk about me, will spend years wishing they could somehow get inside my brain, wishing that they could understand. If I hadn't done what I did, I'd be forgotten. I'd die unknown, except to a handful of people who themselves would be unheard of. I'd have no achievements to my name. No one would even notice that I was gone. It's not why I did it. I didn't crave the notoriety. I never planned this, but I can't pretend it isn't a bonus. My honesty is surprising to some, but it shouldn't be. So many people out there would kill, only figuratively, of course, to have what I have, to be immortalized the way I have been. They'd deny it, acting outraged at the mere suggestion that they envy me. People are so precious about distancing themselves from the darkness inside of them. Everyone wants to pretend that they don't have it, that they are free from demons, untethered from their basest impulses. But depravity is there, lurking inside each and every one of us. For some, like myself, it's a deeper shade of darkness, a shadow filling my lungs like oxygen and pulsing through my bloodstream, feeding me, nurturing me. For others, perhaps, it's tamer, a creature that occasionally wends its way around their conscience, reminding them of its presence. But whether it's loud and raging or timid and mewling, it's there, in everyone. If only the others could throw off the burden of expectation. If only, like me, they could allow themselves to surrender completely to their true nature. But they won't. They can't. They care too deeply about doing the right thing. Even if doing the right thing is little more than a social construct designed to subdue the masses to control the behavior of the many. If everyone was brave like me, I suppose the label serial killer would hold less power. It would be the ordinary, not the exceptional. So, no, I shouldn't take pride in it. Logic tells me that. Society tells me that. But it's who I am. And in the end, everyone in this country knows my name. I'll just take a stab in the dark here, pun obviously intended, and say that that's a hell of a lot more than you can claim. So tell me, who's the real success here? And then the second chapter is from the point of view of Kat. Imogen's door slams, the force of it making me blink. I did my best to stay impassive in the face of her anger. I even managed to refrain from crying in front of her. But still, her words stung, and the tears have started now that she can't see me. I'm completely thrown and totally unsure of how to parent our teenage daughter. I wipe my eyes. Dylan will know what to do. Of the two of us, my husband has always been the sturdy, logical one, whereas I've always reacted emotionally. While I lead with my heart, he looks at a problem from every angle, working through all potential scenarios before arriving at a decision. He'll be able to reach Imogen to make her see that she can trust us enough to tell us what really happened. I want to believe the best in her, like Dylan does. I really do. But she's not making it easy for me. What could be so important that she can't just let us know the truth? And is it really that she can't say, or does she just want to avoid us hearing that she was needlessly violent? Is this her way of appearing innocent, or at least maintaining enough doubt so that we can't officially lay the blame on her? I turn to face Dylan, needing him to reassure me, to tell me that I'm being ridiculous and that this isn't a crisis that I need to obsess over. But he's not even looking at me. He's stretched out on the sofa, one arm over the back of the headrest, the other wrapped around the remote control. Dylan, what? Are you kidding me right now? I see. Our daughter punched someone. She won't tell us or anyone else why. She just screamed at us and stormed out of here. And all you can think to do is watch the bloody cricket highlights. I know you're upset, he says, putting the remote control down on the coffee table. But I think you're blowing this out of proportion. She's a teenager, not a criminal. I stare at him for a second, rage building and threatening to explode. When I speak, it's with all of the restraint that I can muster. I didn't say she was a criminal. Well, sometimes you treat her like she is one. You make her feel like she's a bad person. She told you this? She doesn't need to. I can see it. He's wrong, isn't he? I press my hands to my face, then sink onto the sofa next to my husband. He switches the television off and puts his arm around me. I lean into his chest and listen to his heartbeat. Slow, steady, predictable. You know I'm not trying to see the worst in her, right? Of course I know that, Dylan says, kissing the top of my head, but she doesn't. And at some point you have to make a decision. Either you choose to believe the best, or you let fear get the best of you and you keep obsessing over a worst case scenario that'll probably never happen. I nod slowly, trying to understand how I can make that choice, how to live with the risk, how to turn a blind eye to the facts. Don't you think that ignoring it, that burying our heads in the sand about the truth, could be dangerous? Dylan pulls away from me, twisting his torso to look me in the eye. I know you find it hard, but you need to trust her. You need to trust all of us. I open my mouth to argue, then snap it closed again. I want to disagree with him, want to hide from the accusations he's making. But I'm weary. We've traveled this path before so many times that the way ahead has been smoothed over with use. And so I don't fight. Instead, I put into words the thoughts that I normally don't dare say. You know why I'm worried about Imogen, I say tentatively. Don't make me spell it out. You're wrong, Dylan says immediately. I know why you're worried. Of course I understand why. You think I've never thought about it myself? But she's fine. You can trust her, you know. We've been through this. We've done everything we can. He pauses. and you don't have to worry about her finding out. That's not what I'm worried about, isn't it? He asks, one eyebrow raised. I know you're trying your best, but I think you need to take a look at yourself. Because while you're pretending that you're protecting her, you're smothering her. Imagine how that feels. Imagine how it feels, I think, to be waging constant battle with your daughter. But he can't imagine, of course he can't. He's the good cop, the one who always has her back, the one who's always meant to have my back. But I don't say any of this. I nod and turn away, letting my husband get back to his sport. I'm not going to win this argument. I suppose I just have to accept my role as the bad cop. It's not what I want. It's not what any of us want. But this isn't just about Imogen. She's not the only one in this family. And no matter what Dylan believes, no matter how much he wants to look at the world through rose-tinted glasses, I have to do what I can to protect us, even if what I'm protecting us from is inside our own home. Thanks, I'll hand you back to Vic now.
Thank you so much for that, Elle. That was brill. Okay. I have seen in the chat that Chris McGeorge is now terrified of the hat now that he's actually on the panel instead of just in the audience watching. And I'm afraid to tell you, Chris, it's not you. You live to fight another day. So it is actually Rachel Sargeant. Rachel Sargeant is a top 10 Kindle best-selling author published by HarperCollins. Ooh. She writes about settings she knows but gives them a dark twist. Her latest thriller, The Roommates, is set at a fictional university during Freshers Week. Closer magazine declared it a must-read and Women's Weekly made it Book of the Week. Ooh. Rachel picked this setting as she recently returned to university to do a research degree in creative freedom. Rachel's happy to report that the first few weeks of her studies were far less sinister than those experienced by her characters. So everybody, please welcome Rachel Sargeant.
Hello, everyone. It's lovely to be here. I've tuned in every week to Virtual Noir at the Bar, so it's absolutely amazing to be on the panel. Terrifying, but amazing. So I'd like to read to you the first chapter of The Roommates. It's moving in day at uni and three of the roommates arrive. You should have gone to a Russell Group university. Imo's mother makes her pronouncement after 10 minutes of stop-start traffic inside the campus. She's got her brave face on, pretending to be forthright and normal. Imo shrinks into the back seat and casts an anxious glance outside, but there's no change in the faces of the students walking past. They haven't heard the insult, despite the open car windows. Wide-eyed and chatting, they stream on, like Glasgow, but without the mud and wellies. It's been warm all month. Imo was sunbathing in the garden yesterday, trying to suppress her gut-wrenching nervousness about today. So much is riding on it. Her chance to escape the life of grief and guilt that she and her family haunt. What does her mother mean anyway? What difference does a university league table make to the traffic jam? Has she forgotten for the free-for-all to get into Freddie's uni 4 years ago? But Imo remembers her mother wasn't there. Dad and Imo took Freddie. That day, Mum drove Sophia to Nottingham. Imo holds back a sigh. They were ordinary then. A girl in a bright pink t-shirt steps up to her father's window. Welcome to the Abbey. She hands him a Hessian bag with Abbey Student Union printed on the side in the same pink as the t-shirt. Imo's belly flutters. It's happening. She's becoming part of the exclusive club of students that call it the Abbey, despite it saying University of Abbeythorpe on the website. She leans forward, snatches the bag from her dad and looks inside. Leaflets on the Abbey bar and takeaway, the student welfare service and avoiding STDs, a fresher's wristband and a packet of condoms. She quickly clutches the bag on her lap. If her dad had seen inside, he'd have turned the car around despite them being in one-way traffic, and Imo would have understood. Risk weighs differently in this family. The car park is behind a line of bushes on the right-hand side of the road. They park and debate whether to take the luggage with them. Freddie advises leaving it until they know where Imo's room is. Imo backs his suggestion. anything to avoid her old groovy chick duvet being paraded through the reception. Her mum made her bring it, saying that the uni tumble dryers might damage her new one of the New York skyline. Imo didn't want that one either. It was a birthday present, and she intended to leave everything about that day behind. She'll never be able to look on turning 18 with anything other than ache and horror. A large vehicle chugs into the car park. A boy in a high-vis jacket walks ahead and marshals it lengthways across four parking spaces. It's an ancient ice cream van, painted sky blue, Clouds Coffee in bold purple lettering above the serving hatch. A thick-set woman with hair the same shade of blue as the van climbs out the driver's side. She pulls her seat forward and a girl jumps down. Taller and slimmer than the mother, and tidier too, her hair is short and blonde. Take this, Phoenix. A man in the passenger seat passes her a holdall. Imo can see where she gets her good looks from. Father and daughter are blessed with cheekbones. Not many people could carry off a name like Phoenix, but this girl can. She exudes athletic star quality. Imo's family follows the stream of people towards the main accommodation reception. Sweat seeps into a hoodie, but she can't take it off despite the late summer heat. Even though she got it at the British Heart Foundation charity shop, it's a Jack Wills, and first impressions count. She spent 2 hours on Thursday planning her arrival outfit. Like her mother, she can play it normal. They pass other students and their parents coming out of the building, clutching white envelopes, presumably containing the keys to their home for the next 10 months. On the open day last year, Imo walked into this wood-panelled foyer, giggling with all the other Year 12s on a trip from her school. Was that the last time she laughed and meant it? Not the fake chuckle she gives these days when her family play at real-life charades. She swallows hard. The hall echoes with the chatter of dozens of families. More students in pink t-shirts usher them into three lines. Imo's family stand in the left-hand queue. Imo shifts from foot to foot, unable to stop her legs from wobbling, wishing her parents weren't with her, hoping nobody will recognise them. She swivels her head to look at the whitewashed pillows behind the long reception counter. They're adorned with posters advertising the freshers' welcome party. The line moves swiftly, and soon Imo is in possession of her envelope, with instructions to turn right out of the building, enter the annex at the back, and take the stairs to the first floor. Scared of heights, since Detective Inspector Hare's visit shook the family rigid, since she saw the broken body and imagined the fall, she'd asked for a ground floor room when she filled in the accommodation form, but at least they haven't put it at the top of a tower block. It's been months since she's climbed higher than the second story of any building, even though it's an irrational fear. Detective Inspector Hare got it wrong again. On the steps outside, right in the way of the other families coming in and out, her parents stop for another debate about fetching the luggage. A mini convertible sweeps into the crisscross box of the no parking zone in front of them. A high-heeled black sandal steps out of the driver's side. The sandal strap coils along a slender ankle. When the driver stands up, the strap disappears under the hem of a pair of black Palazzo trousers. The young woman shakes her head, and thick, dark curls cascade over her bare shoulders. She's wearing a white broderie anglaise blouse, a gypsy top, Imo's grandma would call it, but there's nothing rustic about the wearer. Mid-blue, Imo's dad says. That's the colour I'd go for if I ever got one. Imo and her mother share a smile. Only her dad could see a beautiful woman and show more interest in the car. A sudden prickling feeling tells Imo she's being watched. It's a familiar sense, one she's struggled with regularly over the past few months. Freddie has too, even worse for him. She swallows down a knot of fear and forces herself to look at the crowd. Students and parents rush past in the heat, not looking her way. She tells herself it's her imagination. Nobody's recognised her. Then she freezes. A tall, hooded man is standing in shadow under a tree on the opposite side of the street and smoking a cigarette. Dressed all in black, too old to be a student, but clearly not a parent. But it's not Imo he's looking at. He's watching the beautiful woman's every move. His eyes follow her as she turns to lock her car. A shiver runs down Imo's spine. When the man sees Imo looking, she drops her gaze to her envelope, hands trembling. Wariness of strangers is another product of the last few months. And this one looks like a stalker. The young woman puts her keys in her handbag and walks past Imo into the reception, leaving a waft of expensive perfume in the air. When Imo looks back across the street, the man isn't there. Thank you for listening. Back to Vic.
Thank you so much for that, Rachel. I can't wait to read it. Okay, we are on our final person of the middle portion of the evening. Drum roll, please. Don't forget the drum rolls. It's Jennifer Harvey. Jennifer Harvey is a Scot now living in Amsterdam. She is the author of three psychological thrillers with Bukature, Someone Else's Daughter is now available, and two further titles will follow in October 2020 and May 21. So big kudos for Jennifer. She's writing pretty hard at the moment. So everybody, thanks to Jennifer for taking time out of her busy writing schedule to join us at the virtual bar today. Please give her a huge round of applause. It's Jennifer Harvey.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. And thanks, Vic and Simon, as well, for setting this up. It's just so nice that we can still do this kind of thing despite everything. So I'm going to read the very short opening to Someone Else's Daughter, which was published in June. The opening chapter is narrated by Katie, who's the daughter. I suppose in our hearts we all knew she was dead, but hope kept us looking for her. Hope kept us calling out her name. All afternoon we searched for her, scouring the beach as the sun blazed over the dunes. Issa! Issa! Never a reply. Just the wash of waves on the shore and the screech of gulls as they swooped overhead watching us while the sun traced its arc across the sky. Over and over we called her name, telling ourselves she was just asleep someplace, sheltered and safe in the dunes, curled up on the sand and hidden from view by the high marum grass. Eventually, through the fog of sleep, she would hear her name, rub her eyes and call back to us. I'm here, I'm over here. But she never did. We found her at dusk, caught in a hollow where the tide had ebbed, face down in the water and buffeted by the waves, her hair tangled and matted by salt and sand, her skin violet and mottled as a bruise. And I can't stop thinking how strange it is that we were sitting around the bonfire, drinking and singing and joking and oblivious to it all, while she floated alone in the darkness. Perhaps she even heard us singing as she spluttered and choked and drowned. Issa, poor Issa. I still can't believe she's gone. She was the girl we all wanted a piece of, the girl we all wanted to be. So funny and sassy and cool, so clever and beautiful and kind. A girl like Issa wasn't meant to die. And okay, so she was also vain and careless and irresponsible. And she could be secretive and arrogant and cruel. And yes, it's true, she thought the world revolved around her. But that was just how she was. That was just Issa. She was my best friend and my worst enemy, my confidant and my rival. She was the most exhilarating person I had ever known and the most irritating. But whatever I thought of her, good or bad, she didn't deserve to die like that. Not really. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Jennifer. That was brilliant. Okay, so we're going to have a break for 5 minutes for you to get your barman to top your drink up, or, you know, if you've got to do it yourself, then that's the way it goes. But the drinks, I'm sure, are cheaper than when we're in the real bar. So we'll see you all in 5 minutes. Thank you.
Is the loneliest night of the week, 'cause that's the night when my sweetheart and I is to dance cheek to cheek. I don't mind Sunday night at all, that's when my friends come round to call. And Monday to Friday's a blast, and another week goes past. Saturday night is the loneliest night of the week. I sing the songs that I sang for the memories I usually seek, until I hear you at the door, until you're in my arms once more. Saturday night is the loneliest night of the week. Kick out of you. Some they may go for cocaine. I'm sure that if I had even one sniff, it would bore me terrifically too. Yet I get a kick out of you. Well, I get a kick every time I see clear to me, you obviously, you just do not adore me. I get no kick in a plane, flying too high with some girl in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. Yet I get a kick out of you. Thank you.
kick, though it's clear to me you obviously, you just do not adore me. I get no kick in a plane, flying too high with some girl in the sky. Get it. You just give me a, I get a kick out of you.
Jason Isaacs, love it. Can't stop grooving in my seat. I just, I love it. I love it every Wednesday. Oh. So jazzy, obviously. So, Chris, I'm sorry, you're going to have to wait a little. Our next reader is the lovely Sharon Bolton, who is also, I haven't corrected out yet this evening, folks, also featured in Noir from the Bar, a charity anthology. If you haven't got your hands on it yet, you should. It's available on Amazon and at Forum Books in Corbridge. You could do a double whammy, order the book from Forum, support the NHS, and also support a lovely independent bookstore in the Northeast. Anyway, let me tell you about Sharon. She is the author of 12 books and is a Sunday Times bestseller. Woo-hoo! Sharon has been described by the Sunday Times as being unable to write a sentence not suffused with malice. Oh, love it. Sharon lives with her family just outside Oxford, and I am delighted to have her in the virtual bar tonight. So everybody, huge round of applause for Sharon Bolton.
Hi, my new book, The Split, is set on the island of South Georgia in the Southern Atlantic Ocean. It's one of the most remote places on Earth, and you should be able to see it behind me if my virtual background is working. It's the most fascinating place. It's far too good to waste on just one book. And so I wrote a short story called The Snow Bride, which I'm going to read to you now. The ocean is still as glass. The reflection of the mountains and the water so perfect as to be disorientating. I'm not sure which way is up, Rose whispers, as the Snow Queen slips into the bay and even the ship's engines soften, as though the ring of ancient mountains, heavy with snow, is absorbing all sound from the world. The snow's early this year, Eddie says. Can you see the church? Eddie is close and Rose is glad of it. The temperatures have been dropping steadily as they've sailed south, even inside the ship. On deck, before the sun is properly up, tiny shards of ice stick to the inside of her throat each time she takes a breath. And her binoculars have grown so cold, she's afraid they will stick to her skin. Directly ahead, Gripviken lies long and low, rust-coloured, like a smear of dried blood on the foreshore. A ghost town now, dilapidated and dangerous, it bears little resemblance to the thriving whaling centre it once was. There, she says, as she spots the tiny white church at the back of the settlement. A little distance along the bow deck, the ship's first officer is talking to a group of passengers. By the start of the 20th century, commercial whaling had virtually eliminated whales in the Northern Hemisphere, he says, forcing the whaling companies to look further afield. The waters around here were the answer to their prayers. Four stations, Gripviken, Leith, Olaf Harbour and Husvik, Eddie tells her. Over 1,000 men lived and worked on South Georgia in its heyday. It was a tough life. It's possible. The ship's officer frowns at Eddie and Rose, but they aren't paying attention to anyone but themselves and they don't notice. Dangerous work, very cold, especially in winter, some very nasty accidents. Rose feels Eddie shudder against her. But huge rewards, the officer continues. A man could earn more in a year on South Georgia than he could in 5 back home. There was no shortage of young men sailing south to make their fortune. Eddie kisses Rose on the cheek. She thinks his eyes are bluer than the sky. The grass is so green, one of the women gathered around the ship's officer says. Is that because of all the rain? Grass as you know it doesn't exist here, the officer replies. What you can see above the coastline is actually emerald moss. You should also be able to make out the spire of the Norwegian church. Built in 1913, it's been the venue of 16 weddings. Eddie's lips are warm against Rose's cold cheek. Until tomorrow, he tells her. Below deck, the ship's doctor speaks anxiously to the captain. I don't suppose you've seen Miss Carter today, sir. She isn't in her cabin. The old lady. The captain, too, has been uneasy about bringing the frail, elderly woman into such a harsh environment. She's had a nasty cough. I want to make sure it's improving before I let her go ashore. The captain can't help, and the doctor continues his search for Miss Carter. Rose's dress is too big, but all brides lose weight before the big day, don't they? And her hair won't stay in place. The pins of the headdress scratch against her scalp, and she thinks, not for the first time, that it won't be the same without a bouquet. On her feet are lined Wellington boots, but she has her white shoes in a bag on her arm. You look beautiful, Eddie says. He looks beautiful, of that there is no doubt. She's constantly surprised by how tall he is, and she loves the strength in his big, scarred hands. You've forgotten something. He holds out a huge orange jacket. Rose's smile turns into a pout, but she lets him put the jacket around her shoulders. She'll freeze without it, but she's determined to take it off for a few minutes, just as she walks down the aisle. Come on, Eddie says. Time to go. The captain will meet us there. As the last boat ferrying passengers ashore leaves the ship, the doctor raises the alarm. Miss Carter has been seen heading for shore, he tells those of his fellow officers who've remained on board. She's in her early 80s and on the verge of pneumonia. We need to bring her back before she becomes seriously ill. I saw her on deck yesterday, the first officer says. I agree, she wasn't looking well at all. Quickly, they organise a search party, and a boat filled with ship's staff leaves for Gritviken. Snow is falling as Eddie and Rose climb out of the launch and step onto the foreshore at Gritviken, and they are warned by the officer in charge that their visit will unfortunately have to be cut short. As they walk away from the crowd, they hear the guided tour beginning. This has always been a dangerous place, the officer tells his group. Men drowned, died of pneumonia, influenza. Some even froze or drank themselves to death on homemade hooch. The most shocking of all, though, was that of a young man called Almond in 1964, just 2 years before the station closed for good. He got caught between two pieces of moving machinery. It was impossible to get him out, and he was slowly ripped apart. He left a fiancée back home in England. Rose takes Eddie's hand and hurries him along the rough shale path. Almost immediately, they start to climb towards the church. People say he haunts the place, the officer continues, that you can hear his dying screams as the sun goes down. Probably just the wind. Rose waits outside the church and thinks the world is turning white. She's taken off her coat because the music will start any second now. She holds out her hand and sees the snowflakes settle on it like a layer of lace. The bridal march begins. She opens the door, sees Eddie smiling at her from the front of the nave, and walks towards him. The snow is nearly a foot deep by the time the search party reach the church. And back in the bay, the passengers are all hurrying back to the ship. Panting, damp with sweat in spite of the cold, the search party reaches the shelter of the porch, and they pull open the door. The church is empty, but for a solitary figure at the altar. Her grey hair is twisted up beneath a wet and torn veil, and she wears a wedding dress in the style of the 1960s. Melted snow pools around her feet. Miss Carter, the doctor calls, feeling a strange reluctance to go further into the church. Rose? The old lady at the front of the church does not move, and the ship's officers approach her slowly. They find her frozen in place, her dead eyes staring towards a plaque on the wall. Edward Almond, died in Gripviken on the 15th of June 1964, sadly missed by his fiancée, Rose. Thank you. Back to Bic.
So we do have a question for you from the panel, who from Sharon B, saying, I see the population of South Georgia Island is only 32 in summer, 16 in winter. How can you write a murder story with such a limited number of suspects?
It wasn't easy. And a bigger problem than the small population was the lack of infrastructure. There are no roads on South Georgia, just a few dirt tracks that linked the old whaling settlements. There's no airport, so you can't fly there, and everybody gets around by boat. So it's actually the lack of infrastructure that was the challenge to writing the book on South Georgia rather than the small population. But it's a fair point all the same. So half of the book is actually set in Cambridge, which is a very, very different environment.
Great, thank you for that. Sorry about the delay there. Vic temporarily got cut out of the Zoom, but I believe she is back. So, Vic.
Thank you, Simon. And Sharon, I'm so sorry about that. I don't know what's happened with my internet. That was massively terrifying, but I enjoyed what I heard of your reading, which was actually most of it. I think I've just got kicked out just as you were coming at the end. I'm so sorry about that. My goodness, what a night. Right, drumroll please. It's Chris McGeorge, he's doing a happy dance. Oh, Chris, finally your moment has come. Okay, Chris McGeorge read crime fiction from an early age, devouring the works of Agatha Christie and Arthur Conan Doyle. He got into writing when he did a master's degree at City University London. Woo! And his first novel, Guess Who, was written as part of the thesis for that. Since then, Orion has touted Chris as the king of the locked room mystery. Ooh! He is now busy writing his fourth crime novel when he's not messing about online with the rest of those Northern Crime Syndicate dudes. So everybody, please welcome Chris McGeorge.
Hello. I'm going to read today from my second book, Now You See Me, which incidentally is also a novel by Sharon Bolton, which I studied during my MA. But this Now You See Me is about Standage, which is a canal tunnel in Huddersfield, which is the longest canal tunnel in England. And it's about what happens when six young people go in one end on a canal boat and only one comes out the other side. In the interest of time, I did have to cut a little bit, so I'm gonna have to unfortunately do some explaining. Here we meet our protagonist, Robin. He's unconnected so far to the plot, the mystery. He's currently at Waterstones Angel Islington. He's sat at a signing table. And he's trying to flog his non-fiction book, which is called Without Her, which is about his wife, Sam. So here we go. Hello, Robin said as soon as the phone got to his ear. He expected his sister to answer him, but instead a harsh, robotic female voice crackled into life. You are receiving a prepaid telephone call from... A young man's voice cut in, Matthew, before returning to the robot. A resident of Her Majesty's prison, Newhall. If you are on a mobile device, there may still be charges associated with accepting this call. This call will be monitored and may be recorded. If you accept these terms, please press 1. His first thought was that this was a mistake. But then he remembered this person had rung him here 3 times, one after the other. And by the sound of the robot, he had paid for it. Whoever this Matthew was, he really wanted to talk to him. But then maybe poor Matthew had just gotten the number wrong. The robot lady started up again. You are receiving a prepaid, but Robin cut her off by pressing 1, and he waited. Any pretense that this was a mistake was shattered when the same small voice he had heard on the other end said, "Is this Mr. Farringham, Mr. Robin Farringham?" Robin looked around, suddenly in shock, as though he may catch the perpetrator of this weird call in his sightline. But no, the store was almost empty, as it was before, and of course, no one was watching him. "I've been calling," the voice said, almost as if he were reminding Robin he was there. "Who gave you this number?" Robin said, so pointedly that one of the only customers in the shop, an old woman perusing the M's of the crime section, looked around. Robin met her gaze for a split second before turning away. "Who?" "I've been calling." The young man was fumbling for his words. "I didn't think you were going to pick up." "Maybe I shouldn't have," Robin thought, but instead said, "Tell me who gave you this number, or I'm going to hang up." Robin felt something in his gut, a hot rage that he hadn't felt in a long time. He wasn't sure exactly why until the speaker said, "She did. She said her name was Samantha." Robin gripped the phone so hard the sight cut into his hand and his fingers went white. "Sam. Sam? Not no. This had to be some part of a stupid prank made to lower his guard. Robin's finger moved to the red button even as he still held the phone to his ear. It hovered there. Something was holding him back. The number. How had Matthew gotten his number? And then he remembered what his contact at the police had told him, to write everything down, to detail every interaction, no matter how small, because maybe the police could track down the idiot responsible for this harassment and stir up some trouble. Although the last time he talked with his contact was 18 months ago, now he wasn't returning Robin's emails. Robin tapped his pockets with his free hand, finding his signing pen, but no paper to write on. He looked around, searching, and his eyes fell on a copy of Without Her at the top of a pile he had been attending. With barely a thought, he opened the book, rifled through the opening pages, finding the page he usually signed his name on. He put the pen to paper, wrote HMP Newhall and Matthew, and added a question mark. "Who is this?" Robin said, trying to keep his emotions in check. "Did it not? I'm Matthew." Matthew was close to tears. He didn't sound like he was enjoying this. But then Robin didn't know the mind of someone so sick as to do something like this. "Full name." And at that, Matthew did sob. He sounded like a wounded animal. Robin's edge softened slightly. What was happening? "I didn't do it, Mr. Farringham. You have to believe me, I didn't kill them." "What?" Robin said before he could stop himself. "What are you talking about? They think I did it, but I couldn't. My friends." Robin trailed off. There was something in the young man's voice, something so familiar to him. "We went through. All 6 of us, and only I came out," Matthew said through sobs. "Only I came out." "What was this? How do you know Samantha? You have to help me, Mr. Farringham. Please, I need you to say you'll help me." Matthew was openly crying now. Robin shivered. He wasn't feeling angry anymore. He was unsettled. "I'm sorry, but I don't know you, and whoever gave you this number was not who you say it was, so I'm going to hang up now." He stopped and then added, "I'm sorry." And he was surprised to find that he was. Robin took the phone from his ear and was about to terminate the call when Matthew shouted so loudly that it sounded as if it were on speaker. "Clatteridge's, 7:30 p.m. 18th of August, 1996. Robin froze. The single shiver had turned into a cavalcade, coursing through his body. He looked down at the phone in his hand, and then past it, at the open book on the table. Something plopped onto the page, and it took a moment for him to realize it was a tear. Shut the pain away so the anger was back. He put the phone back to his ear. Where the hell did you hear that? That wasn't even in the book. He'd admitted it purposefully. He'd wanted something to keep for himself. That's what she said. She said you wouldn't believe me. So she said to say those words exactly. Clutteridge's, 18th of August, 1996, 7:30 p.m. Robin couldn't think. He had boxed his hope up and put it to the back of the cupboard of his mind. Hope was the worst emotion the people in his position, the ones left behind, could ever feel. And now this Matthew was rifling through the cupboard trying to find it. He closed his eyes and breathed in and out slowly, trying to gain some perspective. This could all be explained away, a coincidence or something like that. That's all, because it couldn't. She rang me, Matthew said, his voice steadier now, as though he were stating facts. In the dead of night, a few years back, I didn't know who she was or why she was calling me or anything. I couldn't even understand her at first. I thought she was either drunk or on some kind of drugs. She seemed flustered, confused. But as she talked, she started to make some sense. She told me her name. Then she said yours. She said, Robin Ferringham is the greatest man I have ever known. The only man to trust. And she said that Robin Ferringham would never, ever let anyone down. This isn't real. It's a trick, just some kind of stupid trick. I didn't remember the call for ages. I think I might have even convinced myself it was a dream. And then I get put in this place, and you're giving nothing but time to think. And I remembered. I remembered her, and I remembered you. A call in the middle of the night, years ago. Clutteridge's. Was it possible, really? I don't believe you, Robin whispered harshly. Although a more accurate sentence would have been, I can't believe you. Can't you just ask her? Matthew said. Robin's breath hitched. Samantha has been missing for 3 years. Silence on the other end. And then a small, what? No, that's not. Please, Mr. Ferringham, you have to. The call began to break up. Robin looked at the phone. He had one bar of signal. He muttered an expletive under his breath and heard a slight tut. The same old woman who had been looking at the crime shelf was standing over him with a copy of Without Her clutched in her hands. It looked rather ragged and well-read, clearly her own copy. The woman went to open her mouth, but Robin put the phone back to his ear. Matthew, Robin said. Matthew. If you don't, the voice was cutting in and out. Robin got up. The old woman was saying something. I've been plucking up the courage to come and talk to you, she was saying, but Robin couldn't focus on her. Robin mouthed a sorry to the woman who was still talking and he pushed past her. Matthew, are you there? Please, the old woman said behind him. Your book changed my life. It made me find peace with my daughter. Please, can you just sign it? On the other end, please, just search Standedge. And then the line went dead. Matthew, Robin said, but knew it was no use. He looked at the phone to see the call had disconnected. He looked around, lost. Are you all right? The old woman said. Robin put his phone back in his pocket, sniffling himself. I'm sorry, that was rude. Of course, I'll sign your book. Sam would have approved. And he talked with the old woman for almost half an hour about her missing daughter and how to cope. And when she was gone, he wrote Standedge down on his copy and underlined it twice. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Chris. You can relax now. I know there's only one studio left, but you can relax. Just think next week you'll be back in the audience and everything will be fine. Okay, so our final speaker this evening is Amanda Jennings. Amanda Jennings writes dark psychological suspense. In her wake was a W.H. Smith fresh talent pick and was the first of her books to be set in Cornwall. I'm going to give a belated woo for the W.H. Smith fresh talent pick. The second was The Cliff House, which the Times called absorbingly atmospheric, beautiful and sinister. Her fifth book and the third set in Cornwall is The Storm, which was published this month. Amanda, has it been published or is it about to be published? Can you put me right? It's about to be published.
Next week.
Next week. Lovely. Thank you for that. Lisa Jewell has described The Storm as Amanda's best novel yet. Amanda has three daughters, a menagerie of pets, and is currently writing her sixth book, which is set on Bodmin Moor. So everybody, our final reader of the evening is the lovely Amanda Jennings.
Have I unmuted? Yes, I really don't like that hat. That was the most nerve-wracking few hat goes that I've had. Thank you very much for having me, and well done to everyone who's still here, and thank you for staying out to hear me. And thanks to Vic and to Simon. So yeah, The Storm is out next Thursday. It tells a story of Hannah and Nathan, who to the outside world live a very privileged life, but behind closed doors it's a different story, with Nathan controlling every aspect of Hannah's life. But why does she let him, and why does she stay? The answers lie in the tragic events of one stormy night in the fishing community of New Lynn in the 1990s. So I'm going to read the prologue, which is very brief, and then the second half of chapter one, where we get introduced to Hannah. The chill December wind blows in gusts, turning drizzle to slivers of glass and scoring the sea with angry white slashes. A boat emerges through the dawn like a ghostly galleon. The man at the helm is rigid and still. He cuts the engine and the small vessel drifts into dock. He moves to the side of the boat and bends for a coiled rope, which he throws over a bollard with ease. He pulls the rope tight and secures it at the cleat. His movements are sure, his features set in somber concentration. The man reaches down and takes hold of the boat's hose, and grim-faced, he washes down the deck, all the surfaces and edges of crevices. He takes great care. He climbs out of the boat and begins to walk up the jetty, but he stops halfway and his head and shoulders slump forward like a marionette with snapped strings. For a few moments, he is motionless, spent, his arms hanging limp at his sides, but then he rallies, straightens his back, forces himself along the gangway past the discarded fishing net, and stacked crates patched with algae and salt stains. Each step is heavy, with the air of a condemned man approaching the gallows. He thinks the port is deserted. He thinks he's alone, with only the waking seagulls and the echo of his laboured footsteps for company. But he is wrong. He isn't alone. There is somebody watching. After our walk, I change quickly, drag a brush through my hair and kiss Cass before walking briskly down to wait for the bus. The bus stop is no more sophisticated than a laminated timetable nailed to a telegraph pole riddled with woodworm on the overgrown verge. It's about a quarter of a mile from the house. I always leave plenty of time to walk down, and as usual, I'm 10 minutes early. I lean back against the telegraph pole and tip my face into the warmth of the sun. For a moment, I allow my mind to drift to where it's desperate to be. With you. We're on the beach at Gadrevi. The sky is the colour of cornflowers, the wind cold and fresh. The mid-October sunshine is bright. Your hand is warm and holds mine tightly, as if you're worried I might blow away. I'm talking too much about everything and nothing. Suddenly self-conscious, I stop myself and look up at you. You smile. Carry on, you say. I'm not boring you. Boring me? You laugh and it sounds like music. How could you ever bore me? It's low tide and the beach. A metal detector like a metronome across the ribbed sand. I can smell the muscle-cloaked rocks, the sea, drying seaweed. You unpack the picnic you made, thin squares of electric pink ham on sliced white spread with margarine. Mum would call you a criminal for not using butter.
Your sheepish smile melts my heart. Your body is hard and muscular, not 1 ounce of fat. The feel of it excites me as I lean against you. I'm sorry, you say. It's delicious, I whisper. Best sandwich I ever tasted. We talk, drink Foster's, smoke roll-ups and kiss. We don't notice the tide coming in until the sea skims our toes. We're trapped. We laugh, jump up, hold hands and wade through the icy water to reach the path. I stumble, giddy from the lager and kissing, and you catch my elbow. Saved you, you say. I miss you. I had no idea how important these moments would become. At the time, it was just a picnic on the beach with a boy I was falling in love with. Something fun to do at the weekend. We had no idea how fleeting our happiness would be. We took love for granted. We imagined we'd always be free. But now the memory of that picnic on Gadrevi is a scrap of precious fabric I cling to like a child with their blanket, comforting and safe, and ragged with overuse. I remember the heat of him. I can taste the cigarettes on his breath. As I let his lips linger on mine, my pulse quickens. I recall the smell of him, the feel of his skin against mine, the sound of his voice as he whispers in my ear. It only takes a moment for the grief to take hold. My stomach pitches with loss and the image of him dissolves, leaving the space where he was, desolate and empty. Regret seeps into every nook of me. If only I could replay that night, do things differently, alter our course. If only. I hear the bus wending its way along the lane and I push myself off the telegraph pole. It draws to a halt and the door opens with a hydraulic sigh. The driver, who's been driving this route for years, greets me like a friend. I count my fare out. I no longer apologise for the coppers. He waits patiently as I drop them into the dish and thanks me when I'm done. I don't know his name, and the only words we've ever exchanged are the occasional comment on the weather and a happy Christmas or a happy new year when seasonally appropriate. I always sit close enough to watch his face in the rearview mirror. He wears his happiness like a medal of honour, right there on show, unashamedly proud of it. He is one of those people who whistle the tune. Sometimes he'll spontaneously smile, and when he does, it makes me glow as I imagine he's recalling something funny or touching. Perhaps he's thinking of his wife and children clamouring around him when he gets home from shuttling backwards and forwards between Land's End and Penzance. I imagine he has a simple life, an allotment, a comfortable threadbare armchair he'll never throw out. I find imagining this man in a life of contentment comforting. My Tuesday bus journey is something I look forward to. On the rare Tuesdays when there's an unknown at the wheel, I can become inexplicably agitated, as if my world has tipped and I am sliding towards the edge. Like I said, routine helps. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you so much for joining us. And I'm sorry you had to wait so long. Okay, so let's tell you, not what's going on next week, but you know, let's wrap things up for you. We have had 3 nominations for Quote of the Week. So, Jane Roberts-Morpeth, Robert Morpeth's quote, Roger came home stinking of shame. Rachel Sargent's risk weighs differently in this family. And Amanda's like a marionette with strap. I haven't even had a drink, this is so unfair. With snapped strings. Those 3 are going to be going up on a Twitter poll in the coming minutes. So you'll have 24 hours to place your bets and choose a quote of the week for VNAPB16. We will be back next Wednesday with another super lineup. Thank you very much to our readers tonight. Thank you very much to the Handsome family for the music. And as always, Jason Isaacs. Thank you to the lovely Simon Buick for keeping all the plates spinning and for stepping into my boots when everything went very wrong here. My apologies for that. So we'll see you next Wednesday. Thank you very much and stay safe.